Welcome to Virtual UKIRK Sunday with UKIRK Greensboro. Happy Easter! We are so excited to worship with you today. Good morning, my name is Reverend Katie Barrett Todd, and I serve as the Executive Director and Campus Minister of UKIRK Greensboro. Before we begin our service this morning, I'd love to take a moment to introduce you to UKIRK Greensboro. We are a PCUSA ministry to college students at colleges and universities in and around Greensboro, North Carolina. Currently, we are reaching and serving students at five schools: UNCG, Guilford College, Randolph Community College, Guilford Tech Community College, and Sandhills Community College. UKIRK Greensboro has a residential ministry in our Presbyterian Holderness House, which is located near two of our campuses. UKIRK Greensboro has been a mission of Salem Presbytery for more than 60 years. For today's worship service, we are sharing with you the talents of some of our current students, as well as our resident coordinator. Each participant has planned and recorded their pieces in their own spaces, in their free time, over their spring semester. Doing so without a spring break this semester due to COVID precautions at their various schools. Along with their spoken liturgy pieces, you will experience a children's message written by an early elementary education major, a piano prelude and postlude, some hymns led by one of our university chorale singers, some more hymns led by a cappella students, and so much more. It is our delight and joy to worship God with you this morning through our sharing of time, talents, and gifts. May the Holy Spirit fill you with joy and wonder. Now, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
We begin our time of worship joining our heads and hearts in prayer with our prayer of the day. Let us pray. Resurrecting God, we sing to the earth of a new song, one of new life, one of new beginnings, one of new creation. The stone has been rolled away, leaving bare our perceptions of what is possible and impossible. As it turns out, nothing is impossible for you. Descend upon us, O God, as we worship you this day, that we might ascend to new heights and proclaim from on high the great and wonderful news. Death no longer has the last word. The word has been turned upside down. The lives of your people have been changed forever. And a new message rises. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Amen.
We join together in calling ourselves to worship, using the words of the responsive call to worship available on the screen. Let us worship God together. God is our strength, our song, our salvation. And so we sing, we shout, we share stories of might and mercy. That God did not let death lay his hands on us. And so we pray, we praise. Hosanna, Hosanna. The stone that the builders tossed aside has now become the most important stone. The Lord has done this, and we marvel. And so this day belongs to the Lord. Let us celebrate.
Christ is risen, shout Hosanna, celebrate this day. Christ is risen, hush in wonder, all creation is amazed. In the desert, all surrounding, see a spreading tree has grown. Healing leaves of grace abounding, bring a taste of love alone. Christ is risen, raise your spirit.
God says to us, "Do not be afraid. The tomb is empty. Go and tell others what you have seen." But all too often, our voices are rendered silent. Our amazement turns to apathy, and fear slows us to a halt. Through confession, though, God liberates our minds and hearts to preach the gospel of resurrection. Let us now confess our sins together using the responsive prayer of confession. The words are available on the screen. Let us pray. We discover the stone rolled away. We see the tomb is empty. We hear that you are risen, but we do not believe. We race to tell the story. We walk and you stand beside us. Our eyes are opened, but we do not believe. We hear you explain it all to us. We break bread with you. We are blessed, but we do not believe. O Lord, help our unbelief. Forgive our stubbornness. Forgive our emptiness. Forgive our faithlessness. Help our unbelief. Open our mouths to listen. Open our ears to listen. Open our minds to comprehend. Help our unbelief. Empower us to preach. Enable us to practice. Call upon us to serve. Help our unbelief. The grave is silent. A new creation has taken hold. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hear now the good news which assures us of our forgiveness. Do not be afraid. The tomb is empty. Anyone in Christ is born anew. We are forgiven and a new life has begun. Amen.
Through his death, Jesus demolished all the things that divide us. The walls we put up to keep others out, walls of hatred, walls of fear, walls of pride. In his resurrection, he proclaimed peace. Peace to those both near and far, friends, enemies, neighbors, and rivals. Through him, God dwells among us, and we live into his peace. The peace of Christ be with you. Now we would like to teach you the peace in American Sign Language.
Peace be with you. And also with you.
My name is Caitlin, and today I'm going to share with you guys a book called Stay This Way Forever by Lindsay Davis. Now, can I tell you a secret about this book? The author, Lindsay Davis, has a son, and she wrote this book as a love letter to him. How sweet is that? Now, before we read this book, I want you to think, what makes you special? And while I'm reading this book, think about what makes the characters in this book special, and maybe you guys share the same thing. Okay? So keep that in your brains. Stay This Way Forever by Lindsay Davis. The sleepy sun is setting, and another day is done. The lightning bugs have dimmed their lights, and bedtime has begun. The moment that you're tucked in tight and you drift off to sleep, I think of all the memories that I would like to keep. Your joyful songs, your belly laughs, the clever things you say, are moments from this fairy tale I cherish every day. Like footprints tracked along the shore, or flower blooms in May, I try to memorize those times before they slip away. I'll hold them close, like I hold you, pressed against my heart, and marvel at the child you are as every new day starts. You wake me up every morning with a grin from ear to ear. Then wrap your arms around my neck. Your snuggles are so dear. You pucker up for kisses, unafraid to let love show. The feeling is pure joy each time I hear your sweet hello. Your giggle makes me giggle as we share a tickle fight. You catch your breath and start to squeal. The sound is pure delight. Sweet child, keep the love and joy in everything you do. Stay this way forever is the wish I have for you. You're curious about the world and everything you see, from dewdrops on a flower to the buzzing of a bee. I'm inspired every day to see things through your eyes, reminding me the world is filled with wonder and surprise. Your innocent and open heart sees only what is good. I hope you stay this way forever, long past childhood. Each day I watch you build the most imaginary things, like castles made for unicorns. And rocket ships with wings. Always keep creating. Let that side of you run wild. So when you find you're all grown up, you'll still dream like a child. When music plays, you're dancing, wiggling, jiggling to the beat. My heart smiles as you close your eyes and move your happy feet. My dream is that you'll stay this way forever and a day, and dance in celebration of your life along the way. When you're hurt or feeling bad, I wipe away your tears, then cuddle close and hold you tight to soothe away your fears. There might be days when things get tough and you just want to hide, but please remember this, my love, I'll be right by your side. I'll always be there watching, trying to keep you safe from harm. You'll never be too big for me to hold you in my arms. I have so many dreams for you and what your life may hold. I'm blessed to have a front row seat to watch it all unfold. But for now, please promise me, as you begin to grow, that you'll stay true to who you are and everything you know. Whether you are 3 years old or even 83, find the feeling in your soul that keeps you wild and free. Fill the world with laughter as you skip and dance and spin, and keep your big heart open wide so love comes rushing in. Create and find the wonderful in everything you do, and stay this way forever, always knowing I love you. The end. All right, friends, what a lovely message that was. Now, did you think about what makes you special? My favorite part in the book was filling the world with laughter through your dance and opening your hearts to let love come through. Jesus was always uniquely himself, even when others looked down on him and shamed him for who he was. Jesus wants you to be you. You are divinely made and divinely loved. Now, my friends, can you pray with me, please? All right. Dear Lord, thank you for loving us as we are each and every day. Thank you for the courage that you place within our hearts to be genuinely us. You have taught us endless love and kindness, and through you, we are able to extend that love and grace to others. Amen.
Thine is the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou o'er death hast won. Angels in bright raiment rolled the stone away, kept the folded grave clothes where thy body lay. Thine is the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou o'er death hast won. Jesus meets us, risen from the deathless love. Bring us safe through Jordan to thy home above. Thine is the glory, risen conquering sun. Endless is the victory thou o'er death hast won.
Our first scripture reading comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. Hear the word of the Lord. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they aren't forgiven." Thomas, the one they called Didymus, one of the 12, wasn't with the disciples when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger in the wounds left by the nails, and put my hand into his side, I won't believe." After 8 days, the disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." And he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hand into my side. No more disbelief. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Jesus replied, "Do you believe me because you see me? Happy are those who don't see and yet believe." Then Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence, signs that are recorded in the scroll. But these things are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing, you will have life in his name. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God.
Our second scripture reading comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36b through 48. Hear the word of the Lord. While they were saying these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." They were terrified and afraid. They thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you startled? Why are doubts arising in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. It's really me. Touch me and see, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like you see I have." As he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. Because they were wondering and questioning in the midst of their happiness, he said to them, "Do you have anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of baked fish. Taking it, he ate it in front of them. Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "This is what is written: the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins must be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God.
Pray. By your Spirit, O God, roll away any stones blocking our understanding, and let light shine in upon us that we may understand the transformative power of the gospel. Amen. I was about 6 years old when I walked into Reverend Dr. Lewis Galloway's office one Wednesday afternoon, sometime between my mom picking me up from the after-school program and the family walking into the fellowship hall for supper. Timidly, I knocked on his door and stepped into his office and was greeted with a warm smile and a, "Hey, Katie, how are you? What can I do for you?" I walked toward his desk and nonchalantly asked, "Dr. Galloway, if God made us, then who made God?" Seemingly unconcerned with the late afternoon hour and the upcoming Wednesdays at Shandon dinner, Dr. Galloway ushered me toward the couch in his office and sat to speak with me, carefully considering what I had asked and how to best answer. The story of Jesus' death and resurrection is a story of trauma. It's a story which the Gospel of John covers in 6 chapters, when the writer spends 13 chapters covering 3 years. For a writer who carefully chooses words to describe the events of Christ's life, we spend an awful lot of time saying goodbye to Jesus and everything that means for us during the farewell discourse in John's Gospel. What I love about these texts from Luke and John is that Jesus chooses to abide with his people when he returns to them. Jesus knows that this has been hard on them. He spends the entirety of John chapter 17 in prayer over the difficulty of this. And most of that prayer is for his disciples, which he prays directly in front of them, where they can hear his every word. The risen Christ comes back to his people who are hurting, and he offers them a blessing of peace. To comfort them, he reminds them of the things that they know to be true from their time with him, the things they have witnessed. He breaks bread with them. He answers their questions. In the middle of their trauma, he abides. Even when the disciples have betrayed him and denied him and announced their fears and shown their hand of everything that would impede their belief, Jesus makes promises. As I read these stories again, the ones that we know by heart that we can tell over and over again, I can't help but draw parallels to campus ministry. Now, I have 2 favorite age groups in the life of ministry, and if it's okay for me to admit that I'm a pastor with favorites, I'll tell you. I love middle schoolers and I love college students. At each of these life stages, people are becoming their own. They are starting to live into the fullness of God's creation. These students are asking questions. They are growing physically and mentally and spiritually, and yes, even in maturity. In these life stages, these life bridges, these students begin to realize the importance of a friend, a confidant, and relationships that look a lot like the love that Jesus preaches, love that will transcend the expectations of the world. Middle school students and college students are wrestling with what they knew and what they are learning and finding as a truth of their own. And we, church, get to walk alongside them if we are lucky. One colleague shares that they are, quote, grateful to get to accompany college students as they unpack the faith of their youth and discern what truths God holds for them in adulthood, end quote. Much like a campus minister sits with a student who is thinking through having a tough conversation with a parent or a friend or a significant other, Jesus sits with Thomas in his uncertainty, and Jesus sits with the other disciples in their fright. Several years ago, Reverend Dr. Will Gaffney gave a first-person sermon that reads similarly to having a conversation with a young adult. I invite you to join me in sitting on the front porch of our UKIRK Greensboro Ministry House to experience this conversation. Let's listen now to Was It All a Dream? A Resurrection Story. Go ahead, pull up one of those rocking chairs. I've been sleepwalking through the last 3 days. It's been a living nightmare. You don't know if you weren't there. I told myself not to go, but I went anyway. I told myself not to look, but I looked anyway. Almost every day, the Romans hang someone from one of their crosses or invent some new form of public humiliation. But this was different. He was such a gentle soul. You should have seen the way children climbed all over him. He could get loud and he could be sharp. His words could cut you to the bone and leave you in tears, but it was always the truth. Whether you wanted to hear it or not, and if you would listen, he would always tell you what would make you whole. I didn't want it to be true, but I saw it with my own eyes. I've spent the last 3 days trying to come to terms with it, and now I hear people saying he's back. At first I was angry. What a horrible, cruel thing to say. People are grieving. People poured their hearts and hopes into that man. There was something about him. It wasn't just the children who were enamored with him. He made miracles like the prophets of old. I saw for myself. They say he was God's son. I don't know. But I know God gave him those gifts and never struck him down. Not even he said that he was the one who was to come. And then the Romans got him. The things they did to him, I can't talk about. But it was just the soldiers who were running wild or everyday brutality. It was deliberate to humiliate him and discredit his name and even his memory. Finally, after a couple of days, I've been able to eat a little and sleep a little. And I hear these stories. And I hear these words, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. You heard it too? I don't want to hear it. You weren't there. You didn't see. You didn't hear. You didn't smell. You don't know what death smells like. That kind of bloody, wretched death. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. At first, it was only a couple of folk, but now it's spreading like wildfire. You know how rumors fly, but this is different. If it were just Mary Magdalene, I'd put it down to her terrible grief, but it's not just her. And Peter, well, he's so eaten up by guilt. I understand, but I wouldn't take his word. But there was Joanna, you know, her husband Chusa, big time. He works for the big man, Herod himself, personal assistant. Anyway, Joanna and Mary, you know the one I'm talking about. No, the other one. Not that James, though. His mother's Mary, too. Every other woman and girl in Judea is named for the prophet Miriam. Anyway, little James's mother, Mary, Susanna, one of the other Marys, it was a whole bunch of them. They all say the same thing. They said they saw him. I don't know. I don't really believe in group hallucinations. And Mary said she touched him. No, not that one. Magdalene, keep up. I forgot about John. He was with Peter, actually. He got there first. And there are the others, all saying, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. What if it's true? What does it mean in this world that looks the same, where there are still crosses on that hill? There is a hope that the empire cannot take away from us, even with the threat of death, even with the certainty of death. This story about Thomas is not a story about skepticism or doubt. It's a story about trauma, and Jesus recognizes this immediately. Thomas needs a bit of help because he's still processing the loss of his mentor, his friend, his guide. Thomas, the one who discovers for us in John chapter 14, verse 5, that Jesus is the way, just needs a little bit more time. Because all of a sudden, people are saying that Jesus isn't dead anymore, and he has yet to see him and know that it's real. Jesus meets him there, answering his demands point for point. And then Jesus pushes Thomas. As the disciples are walking down the road and processing the entirety of Jesus' ministry, this referenced in verse 36, Jesus appears to them and scares to help them process, their teacher, their rabbi, gives them tangibles. They see his injuries, he breaks their bread and shares their fish. Jesus knows exactly what they need, meets them there in the middle of the moment of fear and insecurity and grief and uncertainty to remind them of promises made and showing them that the promises have been kept. And then, like Thomas, he pushes them. Today we heard Caitlin read the book Stay This Way Forever, which is a letter to a child from a parent. Author Lindsay Davis wishes her child would retain certain qualities for their whole existence. Quote, you're curious about the world and everything you see. Your innocent eyes and open heart sees only what is good, she says. When you're hurt or feeling bad, I'll wipe away your tears. There might be days when things get tough and you just want to hide. But please remember this, my love, I'll be right by your side, she encourages. We picked this book specifically because it reminds us of Jesus here with Thomas and the other disciples. It reminds us that as we grow and change, and as things become scary or hard or traumatic, God is right by our side, abiding with us. And then, like the author challenges their child, saying, quote, keep your big heart open wide, so love comes rushing in. Stay true to who you are and everything you know, end quote. Jesus challenges us, pushes us to live into the fullness of God's truth for us. Church, these texts today have a lot to teach us about the importance of our campus ministries, our bridge ministries, our faith-sustaining ministries to students in the in-between times. The faith of our childhood becomes the faith of our adulthood only when it's given space to grow when it's challenged, to struggle when it's uncertain, to resurrect when it has died. When we baptize a child in our congregation, we commit to seeing them from birth unto death here on earth. This means we commit to doing so when they are in our pews, when they are quarantined in their homes and don't yet feel that it's safe for them to return to worship in a building, and when they leave our presence to test themselves out in the world, whether they ever step foot back in our doors or not. Like Jesus, we must offer all of God's children, and particularly the ones we have baptized with our fonts, the chance to need more, the chance to question for themselves, the chance to grieve the traumas they've experienced, especially the ones that we may have caused. And we must remind them all the way that they are not alone. We are with them. We see them. We love them. We support them. And we will give them what they need when they need it. Invite the Thomases to see your hands and your feet and your side. Show up where the other disciples are and breathe a blessing of peace on them. And after you've abided for a while, gently push. Watch them fly. That question I asked Dr. Galloway still remains, but so does his answer and the memory of our time together that day. It's a memory as vivid as the sound of the birds that chirp, the smell of the pollen in the air, the warmth of the sun on the skin, the taste of the body and blood of Christ at the table, and the sight of flowers popping up from the ground. The details of that meeting may not be exactly as I recall, but the time taken to abide with me will never be forgotten. That pastor took the time to sit with me and answer what was a pressing question at the time. He saw it and he went with it. And then, many years later, that same pastor pushed a bit, asking me, a senior in college, a question in turn. A question that made me stop. A question that led to where I am today. A question that challenged me to see God anew. Siblings in Christ, new friends, church, although they aren't in our midst, the children of God in our congregations need us to be and abide with them, and then to gently push them, for it's through us that they will experience God at the table, at the font, in the pew, on campus, in the world, in the valley, afresh and anew. Amen. May it be so.
Having heard the word proclaimed, let us join our voices together to affirm our faith. Siblings in Christ, what do you believe? In the death of Jesus Christ, God's way in the world seemed finally defeated, but death was no match for God. The resurrection of Jesus was God's victory over death. Death often seems to prove that life is not worth living, that our best efforts and deepest affections go for nothing. We do not yet see the end of death, but Christ has been raised from the dead, transformed, and yet the same person. In his resurrection is the promise of ours. We are convinced that the life God wills for each of us is stronger than the death that destroys us. The glory that life exceeds our imagination, but we know we shall be with Christ. So we treat death as a broken power. Its ultimate defeat is certain. In the face of death, we grieve, yet in hope, we celebrate life. No life ends so tragically that its meaning and value are destroyed. Nothing, not even death, can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Now is a time when we have the privilege of coming before God to offer the prayer of our hearts and minds and community. Take a moment to consider all for whom you might pray this day. Let us pray. God of light and mystery and surprise and life, we are the women who go to the empty tomb. We mourn the loss of loved ones. We do what we can to keep things moving because the pain is too fresh, too real for us to bear. So we go on with our day in, day out lives to keep things normal. But really deep down, we're in shambles. We don't know what to do. We don't know where to turn. We don't know what to make of our lives. We are the women who go to the empty tomb. We are Peter, fresh from the denial. If we could go back and change things, we would. If we could have another chance, we'd take it. We spend our lives living in regret for what we've done. We wallow in the guilt and where it has left us, stewing, venting, grieving. We are Peter, fresh from the denial. We are those on the walk to Emmaus. We don't recognize Jesus in our midst, even when he stands there and speaks directly to us. Instead, we question, we doubt, we wonder. We even pretend to know who Jesus is, though our explanations are by no means complete. We are just left walking the road, thinking we know where it'll take us, when really we're lost. We're all of these people who deep down only want to follow you, to the point that we'll bow our faces to the ground in your presence. We'll run as fast as we can to see if the tomb really is empty. We'll let our hearts burn within us if only our eyes will be open to you. We're all of these people who long to be yours. So claim us, redeem us, forgive us, save us. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The resurrection may be hard to believe because there are places in the world where death seems to have the last word. And there is tremendous brokenness, heartache, and ugliness in our world. But we worship a God who overpowered death to emerge alive from a tomb. Just as the resurrection transformed the cross from an instrument of death into a symbol of life, that power can transform the ugliest, most broken parts of our world into places of beauty. Christ has overcome death and come to us so that we might believe, even in the midst of our doubt. Our offering this morning is to bring what little faith we have in the form of our tangible gifts. Together, may we offer up our handfuls of faith and our transformation of the cross in gratitude to God. During this time, you are encouraged to give your offerings as you would typically give to your congregation. This offering is an offering of gifts, of self, of service, of prayer, of time, of resources, of talents. Should you feel moved to support the mission of UKIRK Greensboro, a PCUSA ministry to college students in and around Greensboro, you may do so online or by mail. The address is on your screen. Now, let us give our offerings to God this joyous Easter morning.
We walk by faith and not by sight, with gracious words drawn near. Oh, Christ, you spoke. Help then, O Lord, our unbelief, and may our faith abound to call on you when you are near and seek where you are found. And when our life of faith is done,
from whom all blessings flow. Praise Christ, all people here below. Praise Holy Spirit evermore. Praise Triune God, whom we adore.
Let us pray. Gracious God, receive now our offering, which is just a portion of the blessings you have given to us. Use these gifts and use each one of us as a living offering to you, for your glory and for your work of healing and wholeness in our world, our campus, in our congregations, in our homes, and wherever you send us to go or need us to be. Amen. Thank you.
Go to the world. Go into all the earth, go preach the cross where Christ renews life's worth, baptizing as the sign of a rebirth. Alleluia, alleluia. Go to the world, go into every place, go live the word of God's redeeming grace, go seek God's presence in each time and space.
As you depart from your space of worship today, go into the world knowing that you are loved, knowing that the God who makes promises keeps them, and go knowing that even when it's hard or frightening or traumatic, the Spirit of God joins you to abide with you there until you are ready to be pushed. Now, may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working among us that which is pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, the one who abides with us and pushes us, and the one to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed.